Law school. I often think that's the direction I should have gone. More secure employment. On the other hand, 40 years here, it's a certain level of security. And it is truly a privilege that if you understand anything about being an archivist, to be able to be associated with the same institution for so long builds a depth of knowledge and experience. Yes, you can get caught in a rut, but the knowledge that you're able to bring to bear on a day-to-day basis is something which is satisfying in a way that, unfortunately, few of you will have the opportunity. And to me, that's just the joy of the job, pleasure of the day. So I have some prepared remarks here, prepared, actually. Hi, Annie. That's my granddaughter, Annie, being held by Kara. Thank you. When Robin Kaler called to inform me of this award, I felt a mixture of honor and intimidation at the thought of being put together with Winton and Maynard, because I knew that without them there would be very little to celebrate in this sesquicentennial year. For my part, what I've been able to accomplish has never been a solo work. It's depended on the talents, insight, hard work, and occasional constructive friction from all of the archive staff over the years. There have been hundreds of undergraduate and graduate student assistants, academic hourlies, and volunteers to provide references, arrange and describe collections, and develop technology. Today, I'm fortunate that nearly all, one is ill, of the archive's permanent staff are here so you can acknowledge their essential contributions to this award. Assistant University Archivist Christopher Crom, Stuart S. Howe Student Life and Culture Archivist Alan Swain, SUSE and American Music Archivist Scott Schwartz, Electronic Records Archivist Joanne Kazmarek, and Faculty Papers Archivist Suzanne Bellavara. Especially important to our reference work, daily operations, outreach, the American Library Association Archives, and handling of born digital records and scientific records, are specialists Linda Stocky Stepp, Bethany Anderson, Kara Bertram, Demetrius Rimkus, and Anna Trammell. Two former civil service staff, both departed, deserve mention. Evelyn Arvidson saved me when I arrived here. I had 12 days to work with Maynard, and then he went off on sabbatical for 6 months in Germany. And if it were not for Evelyn Arvidson, I would have crashed the program. The other late Robert Chapel, also in that technical support role, provided a really important transition over the period when Maynard retired and I became the archivist. And Robert really assumed a lot of charge of reference inquiries and did a masterful job in that area. And he was warmly recognized by many researchers for that. I also need to note, in terms of the archive's history, my predecessor, Charles Elston, the former specialist archivist, John Straw, the first student life and culture archivist, Elizabeth Cardman, who worked as both assistant archivist and coordinating the ALA archives, and the late Phyllis Danner, who was in charge of the SUSE archives in the 90s. On their behalf, and in their in the recognition of the work of all who come before, I'm proud to accept the Chancellor's Medallion in recognition of the great work of the archives team. As Maynard always emphasized, the only reason that the archives exist is so that they are used and accessible. What better way to illustrate this point than that the Chancellor's Medallion be awarded to Winton Solar? Over the past 60 years, he's been personally responsible for 3 books, with one more coming, 9 articles, and mentorship of multiple dissertations, theses, and student papers on university history. Winton's research is fueled by the conviction that university history should be treated as histories of ideas, not just chronicles of great men and women and signal accomplishments. 40 years ago this April, the head of the Smithsonian Institution Archives advised me that the best way for me to pursue a career in archives was to connect with Maynard Bridgeford. With that recommendation and its enthusiastic endorsement by Beryl Manning, then the Washington University archivist and my supervisor, I made a pilgrimage to Urbana to see who exactly this archival paragon was. Walking into room 19 archives in the basement, I wondered at the unimpressive quarters, which in what was essentially an unfinished basement. it still largely is. This was quickly overshadowed by Maher. He showed me then, and over the next 18 years, an excitement for why records and archives matter to the university and to the world at large. He's been a model to the profession and legendary among users because of his attention to detail, his belief in the importance of the past, and his passion for using its lessons to make a better future. In the 22 years since Maynard's retirement, the only way I've been able to make my own small steps of matching his legacy has been to remember the principles he put first. Archives matter because they are for the user and the future. So I'd like to thank Chancellor Jones and Provost Wilkin for bringing this recognition to these remarkable individuals. I will also add a footnote here. One thing which is mentioned in my remarks, but wasn't touched upon in Maynard. This has long been a debate among academic archivists in the United States of, is the library a good place to be situated? Maynard and I could sit and complain long about all the difficulties the librarians up on the second floor were giving to us. But he also made the case, and he convinced me, that the library, the research library of this caliber, is the right place for an academic archives because it brings together those research values with the collections. And for that, I want to thank especially the two most recent university librarians, Paul Kaufman and John Wilkin, and think that with what's developed in the archives over their tenure, they have really fulfilled the vision of Robert Downs, who was the librarian at the time the archives established. And I thank you all for coming today.